Calculating the convolution of a matrix with a filter has to do with this idea that the filter is placed in some sense on top of the matrix, and it can be seen as a shifting window that goes step by step through the matrix, and in each position you calculate an element-wise multiplication. So visually you can see it like this. We have this filter, and the filter is placed in the top left of your matrix, and here we have the element-wise multiplication, and the result is then corresponding to this top left corner. You have the result placed here in the top left corner of the result, and then the filter shifts one position to the right, and you do the same calculation, and then the result is placed on the one position to the right in the output, and you continue in the same way until you get to the end of the matrix on the right side. And then the filter shifts to one position lower, and it starts again from the left, and it continues this sort of scanning step by step through the matrix, and each time you calculate this element-wise multiplication, and you place the result in a corresponding position in the output matrix. So there are two points to make about this way of calculating convolutions. One is that you see, the way you start with calculating the convolution is that the filter is placed here on the top left of the corner of the top left corner of the matrix, and then it continues shifting one position to the right. So what this means in particular is that there is no way for the center of the filter to start anywhere closer to the top left corner than in this position. If you have a 3x3 filter, if you have a 5x5 filter, it even starts a little bit lower and a little bit more to the right. So in other words, this filter, because it has to start scanning in such a way that it's placed in the top left corner, misses the information on the first row, and with a bigger filter, even on more than, it's going to be more than just the first row, maybe the first two rows and so on. And the same is true, as a matter of fact, for the first column. You also miss the information on the first few columns. And the same is true also for the information on the last few columns and on the last few rows. The center of the filter never has a chance to scan those positions, because that would mean that the filter would hang somewhat, outside of your matrix, and then that would make your calculations impossible. So that's one point to make, that you don't take advantage of a lot of information sitting on the edges of your input matrix, and that's a problem, because that's potentially valuable information that you might want to use in your learning algorithm. The other point to make is that, again, as a consequence of this thing that you don't really scan the whole matrix in an equal way, the output, the size of the output is going to be smaller than the size of the input. And that's, again, because you are missing the first few rows and columns and the last few rows and few columns. And that becomes a problem if you have a deep convolutional neural network and you have a number of layers with convolutions, and in each layer you are actually shrinking your input size. So if you start with a certain image, after a few convolutions you might get a very, very small image, and that's going to make learning very difficult. So you need to have a sort of a solution for avoiding this shrinking in each layer, in each convolutional layer. So one way to get around this and then solve both of these problems is to, in fact, think about this padding idea. So you would, in fact, pad around your input matrix. So you would essentially add, let's say you add one row in the beginning and one row in the end, and one column in the beginning and one column in the end. And you are filling all these extra entries with zeros, just whatever it's a zero is a good choice, so that you don't really influence the calculation of the convolution. So you put zeros everywhere in here, with a 3x3 filter this is going to be just enough, because in this way you are going to be able to place your filter now starting from this corner, and that means that you are going to be able to scan you know, the first row of your original matrix and the first column of your original matrix, and the same goes for the last row and last column. If you had a bigger filter, then you might need to pad even more. Maybe you need to add you know, padding of 2, and that would mean that you have 2 extra rows in the beginning and 2 extra rows in the end, and the same in terms of columns. So if I'm denoting by P the amount of padding, meaning the number of rows you are adding in the beginning and in the end of your matrix, and the same for number of columns, so visually P would be this much, how much you are adding here, and obviously you would have P also in here, and you would have this much here, and you would have this much here. So this would be the size of the padding you would be doing. Now, if you consider this kind of padding, the way the size of your matrix goes is like this. You would have in the input, just like before, let's assume you have a image of size W times H, so width and height. And let's say that you do padding, and you do a padding of size P, so then the size of your input after padding is going to be W plus 2P times H plus 2P. And if you use a filter that's F by F, then the size of your output is going to be, you will have a shrinkage, but the shrinkage is going to be with respect to this input after the padding. So the size of the output is going to be W plus 2P minus F plus 1 times W plus 2P minus F plus 1. Question of how to choose the padding size. In deep learning terminology, there is this idea that you would have two types of convolutions. One is, we say that we have a valid convolution essentially if you choose to have no padding. So the padding P is going to be equal to 0. This is called a valid convolution for one reason or another. And then you have another type of convolution, which is it's called, again in deep learning terminology, same convolution, and that means that you calculate your padding in such a way that the output size is the same as the input size, so that you are avoiding this shrinkage problem. So as a matter of fact, the same convolution only works if you have square images. So this only works if the width and the height are equal, and let me just denote them by n. So the input size of your matrix is going to be n times n, and the output size, you know, after using padding of size P and using a filter of size F, the output size is going to be n plus 2P minus F plus 1 times n plus 2p minus f plus 1. And so you want to have these same convolutions so that the output size is equal to the input size. So what this means is that you would like to have n equal to n plus 2p minus f plus 1. And that implies that you would be choosing a padding of size f minus 1 over 2. So a couple of comments about this conclusion. Because of this, usually the filters are chosen to be of odd size. Because once you have the odd size, then you have you know, this calculation here that gives you an integer for the amount of padding. So that makes you know, the type of padding you do symmetrical with respect to what you pad on the left and to the right, and what you pad on the top and on the bottom. If you were to choose a filter of even size, then this division by two wouldn't give you an integer. So what that would mean is that you would pad with slightly different amounts on top and on the bottom, and slightly different on the left and on the right. So that would give you a slightly asymmetrical situation, which is maybe not an argument against this. This could still work, but typically filters are chosen of odd size, so that you have symmetric padding, you know, top, bottom, and left, right. Another concept that's very often used in convolution is that of strides. And I want to show you this concept using this calculation. I have this time a matrix that's 7 by 7, and I'm using this filter that's 3 by 3. And the idea of the convolution with strides starts in the same way. You have this filter, and you place it in the top left of your matrix. And you do the usual, you know, element-wise multiplications, except that, you know, to compute, so the result is placed in this top left corner of your output matrix, except that when you want to calculate the next one, you know, one position to the right, in the input matrix, you are going to, in fact, shift your filter not with one position, but potentially with more than that. And let's say that I'm dealing with a stride of two. So that what that would mean is that the filter is going to be shifted now two positions to the right. So it's going to go like this, and then you do your usual element-wise multiplication, and you place the result, you know, one position to the right in the output. And then the next time you shift your filter, again, is going to be with two positions to the right, if I'm working with a stride of two. So that's going to get it on this position, and that's going to give you the output here, one position to the right, in the result of the convolution. And then when you go to the next row in calculating the convolution, that would mean that you shift the filter all the way to the left, but you also shift it downwards with two. Again, if I have a stride of two. So that would mean you shift your filter to this position. And then it continues in the same way. You shift it to the right again with two positions and so on. So that's a useful way of you know, manipulating convolutions. That's going to give you a shrinkage in the output, but that's sometimes desirable for various reasons that we will discuss in a future video. And the way the sizes of your inputs are calculated is like this. You have a input. Again, it's of W times H. And then you have, let's say, padding. And the padding, say it's P. Let me also write here the filter. Filter is F times F. And then you also have the stride. And let's say that you choose a stride of S. So then the output size is going to be like this. You will have, like before, you will have W plus 2P minus F, but because you are shifting not one position to the right and one position to the left, but in fact you are skipping position, that's going to be divided by S, and then plus 1 times, and then we have the same thing in terms of the height, is going to be H plus 2P minus F divided by the stride plus 1. And obviously this division might not be an integer, so we are taking the floor of this division here. And what this means, in fact, when you take this floor operator here, what this means is that when you have your filter and the stride is maybe indicating that you should place it, you know, slightly hanging outside, then you are going to skip that calculation. You only calculate the convolution for those locations of your filter which are completely inside your matrix. That corresponds to this idea of taking the floor operator of this division.